God forgave my sin. In Jesus' name, I've been born again. In Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name, I come to you to share His love as He told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received. Freely, freely give. Go in my way, and because you believe, others will know that I all power is given in Jesus' name, in earth and heaven, in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name, I come to you to share His power as He told me to. He said,
everyone. It is good to have you back with us again. Here it is, a brand new year. 2020 is gone, and for the first time, it is true, hindsight really is 2020. So it is good to have you all back with us again. Last week it was kind of unusual because I was preaching and recording the sermon that would be available on the last Wednesday of December, but the video will also be shown on the first Sunday of January. So it was a sermon that actually split over the time frame of 2 years. So that made it kind of interesting and fun. Thank you so much for your faithfulness. Thank you for your prayers and your words of encouragement. I appreciate all of those so very, very much. Now, I have a prayer today that has been submitted by Tom Carter. He is a United States Army chaplain, retired, and he is a resident at Westminster Winter Park. And he writes this prayer. By your word, Lord God, you set free every person imprisoned with themselves to freedom you have called us and to become people in your image. We ask you, give us the strength for the life you provided. Give us the openness for which you prepared us. Make us receptive and free, so that with you we may live for you and all your children. We thank you, God, our peace, for being alive tomorrow and today, for this earth, for bread and light, for the people around us, today, yesterday, and every day. We thank you for our lives here and now, lives laborious and full of joy. May neither future nor death separate us from your love, which is for all people and all the earth. Amen. Now, we're going to be taking a look today at Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. That's Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation. It's going to pop up on your screen, and we're going to share this time together. So here is the passage. Again, Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. These are the words of the teacher, King David's son, who ruled in Jerusalem. Everything is meaningless, says the teacher. Completely meaningless. What do people get for all their hard work under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth never changes. The sun rises and the sun sets, then hurries around to rise again. The wind blows south, then turns north. Around and around it goes, blowing in circles. Rivers run into the sea, but the sea is never full. Then the water returns again to the rivers and flows out again to the sea. Everything is wearisome beyond description. No matter how much we see, we are never satisfied. No matter how much we hear, we are not content. History merely repeats itself. It has all been done before. Nothing under the sun is truly new. Sometimes people say, here is something new, but actually it is old. Nothing is ever truly new. We don't remember what happened in the past, and in the future generations, no one will remember what we are doing now. That was Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Now, this passage is an interesting one. But as we approach another year, here it is at the very beginning. A month is in the process of ticking away. At times like these, the mind races in several different directions. We think back about last year and ponder our experiences. If it has been a good year, in our opinion, we smile and trust that all will continue to prosper. If it has been a bad year, in our opinion, we look forward to the new year with hope that things will improve. If the year has been a mixed assortment of good and bad, in our opinion, then we try to filter out the bad and we try to keep the good. This requires us to continually evaluate the paths that we have walked and do our best to avoid the landmines that plagued our yesterdays, while all the while trying to determine exactly what we did to bring about our successes. In short, it is a dizzying array of futile attempts to chart our life's course by our own abilities, with a reckless disregard of the truth that there is one who is in charge and provides us with the strength and power necessary to make an impact where we live that will have eternal results. Now, as I've stated, if we look back at last year and we say, oh, it was a good year, in our opinion, or if we would look back at last year and say, it was a bad year, in our opinion, I think that most of us would probably fall into the third category, that we see last year as a mixed bag of good and bad. I don't think there's anyone that would say, boy, I'd really like to go through 2020 all over again. I don't think we're there. There may be some brave soul out there that would like to attempt it, but not me. I'm glad that 2020 is over because we have so much promise of what is lying ahead in this new year. So many new opportunities. We have learned lessons, haven't we? We are different people than we were 12 months ago. And so as we look at this passage, there are several things that I'd really like for us to take a closer look at, okay? First of all, God sets boundaries for our self-perception. There are boundaries there. God uses Solomon to teach us. We find that he was King David's son. He was considered to be the wisest man. Now, when God gave him the choice to choose anything, he chose wisdom. And God said, "Because you have chosen wisdom, I shall add all these things to you." So God gets our attention as we think and ponder. He gets our attention by saying, "Everything is meaningless. Nothing we do on earth has meaning." Wow. That grabs a hold of me when I hear that statement, that everything is meaningless. Nothing really matters. But God shows us the toils of life. It is wearisome, we're told, beyond all description. We can never see enough to be satisfied. We can never hear enough to be content. And I would add another point in there, that we cannot receive or gain enough to be truly happy. A wealthy man was once asked, "If you could have everything in the world, if you could have all the money in the world, what would you want?" He said, "Just a little bit more. Just a little bit more." So you see, as humans, our perspectives become skewed in the way that we look at things, the way that we consider things, the way that we ponder what really has meaning and what does not. Now that we have been told of the insignificance of life's activities, where do we go from here without feeling defeated and discouraged? That's a logical question, isn't it? So God goes on in this passage and he uses nature to demonstrate the flow of life, the rising and the setting of the sun. What does it mean? The blowing of the wind. What does it mean? The flowing of the waters. What does it mean? Can we declare the meaning of the cycles of the earth? The rising and setting of the sun, the blowing of the wind, the flowing of the waters. Can we declare the meaning of those cycles? No. We have no control over them. We have no way of determining when one is going to happen or the other. You see, they are all under the control of God in all aspects. Just as the cycles of nature are controlled by the hand of God's providence, where do our lives find their true cycle? Where are our lives on the circle of life? It's another good question. This passage really causes us to think, and to think deeply. So as we look at the third point, we find that the permanence of the results of our activities will only be realized in the light of the eternal. We're doing things today and we say, you know, this doesn't matter. 1,000 years from now, no one will care. Really? Can we really say that our lives are that insignificant? Verse 3 spoke of man's earthly work, a toil for self-satisfaction under the sun, meaning here and now, living a life. We cannot live idle lives. We are expected to be doing something. We're not expected to be idle and complacent. So what we do to live must be done again over and over and over. It says, nothing new. Really? Another week for another paycheck to meet the needs. Nothing ever really changes. Sometimes it feels that way, doesn't it? Sometimes the days run into weeks, the weeks run into months, and the months run into years, and it seems that we are on a cycle, we are on a treadmill, and one thing just keeps going around and around and around like a merry-go-round. But what do we do that cannot be held in one's hand? We talk about the things that we do, how we live, what we gain. But what do we do that cannot be held in one's hand? We all understand the things and stuff. As with the elements of nature, our lives must be guided and sustained by the providence of God. Our lives are no different than the cycles of the world, the cycles of nature, the cycles of God's providence. As with the elements of nature, our lives must be guided and sustained by the providence of God. What is in your life that cannot be touched? Where does your life intersect with the eternal? Like I said, this passage causes us to pause and to think. God's guidance and sustainment is found in relationship with Him, not in life's ongoing toils and struggles in our own strength. Our sustainment and guidance is only found in its proper place in relationship with God, not in the toils and struggles, not in the size of our bank accounts, not in the size of our family, the type of house that we live in or apartment. Our lives are not guided by those things. The guidance that we need in our lives comes from God, and His sustaining hand provides all that we have. So God expects us to determine what is permanent and unchanging. Here's the final point. God calls out to us. He challenges us to determine what is really important. What is really going to stick around? What in all of this is unchanging? What is going to remain long after we're gone? History, it says, repeats itself in cycles. This means that it can be anticipated. It is at those intersections of life that we can allow God to place us in a position to make an impact for change. If everything happens in cycles, then God moves our life into the right position to intersect possibilities of change. God puts us there to deliberately make a difference. Though we may never be remembered for what we have done, people will always remember what God has done, and it may have been through us that He did it. Now, our lives sometimes can seem so insignificant. And honestly, we can say, I just don't think that much is going to come of my life. I don't think that I've been able to accomplish much in my life. When I'm dead and gone, I will just be forgotten, and my life will not matter. It will not have any consequence, but that's not true. Every one of our lives make an impact in this world. We may not be able to see it. We may not be able to express it. We may not be able to understand it. And as we throw up our hands and we say, oh God, show me where my life is making a difference. That's an honest request. It's a heartfelt request. And if we do that with an open mind and an open heart and look to God, He will show us the difference that our life is making. Do not be surprised that if it's in smaller things than you would have ever imagined. You're looking for big things to make big impacts. Many, many times God uses the small things to make huge impacts. It's the common, it's the ordinary, it's the systemic items in our life that God uses and fills and blesses as we live out our lives to the best of our ability for Him, not for our own gain and credit, but for Him. So you see, Solomon, though he said all is meaningless, that's kind of a disheartening way to open a passage, isn't it? Everything is meaningless, or vaporous is the way one translation puts it. Vaporous, vaporous, all is vaporous. And then saying nothing is new. Solomon was not a defeatist. Remember his wisdom and the fact that he was used of God. Here we stand within just a few days of a new year having begun. Just a few days ago, we celebrated a brand new year. Now comes the question, how will you face it? And what is your perception of the year that has passed? If history repeats itself and there is nothing really new, then why do we continue to do the same things and expect a different result? Change, you see, only comes when we allow God to become the primary source of strength in the cycles of our lives. Then and only then will we be used to make an eternal difference. Though our lives may seem vaporous, our lives truly have meaning, and God uses our lives to make an impact and a difference. That's why we are here. That's why we walk this earth. That's why we interact with people, to make a difference so that God may be glorified in our life. Amen. Thank you so much again for being with us. I'd like to close with the Westminster Prayer. Creator God, we ask you to bless our Westminster community and all who live and work within it. May this place be filled with deep caring, welcoming hospitality, and dedicated respect. May all who visit here be greeted with warmth and kindness. May all who live here be graced with God and peace. May all who serve here do so in the spirit of Jesus, whose deep love and dedication to healing touched all he encountered. Amen. Again, I'm so proud to be able to share with you. I am so overjoyed by having each one of you in my life, that we can be in ministry together. This new year marks some new things that are going on. We have a grief support group that gathers in the Bistro dining room right across from the marketing office. We meet there on Mondays at 10 a.m. On Tuesdays at 10 a.m., we have a Bible study, Waiting for God. That'll be a relaxing time. No previous Bible knowledge necessary. It will be a good time together, trust me. And then on Wednesday, we have a dementia Alzheimer's support group, again, that meets in the Bistro dining at 10 a.m. in the morning. So Monday, again, Monday, 10 a.m. in Bistro dining is the grief support group. Tuesday morning, 10 a.m., Bistro dining, Bible study. Wednesday morning, 10 a.m., Bistro dining, Alzheimer and dementia support. So put those things on your calendar. Come and be a part of these groups. Come and be a part of this ministry. Show up for chapel. Our chapel services are going to be moved over to the Tides Gallery B. That means it's the small room on the west end of our new multipurpose room. We will be holding our weekly in-person chapel services there at 2:30 Wednesday afternoons. Come and be a part of that. I promise you a blessing. God will not disappoint. Thank you again for being with us. Be a blessing to all those you come in contact with this week. Amen.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died. because he loves.